Welcome to Unapologetic Live and happy Monday. I hope you guys had a fantastic weekend. For those of you who celebrated Easter, happy Easter. I hope that was good for you. Today, we come to you with a special episode. Of course, every day it's a special episode, but today is a special episode nonetheless, where we're going to be going through the life of somebody who is actually transitioning from male to female. This is a TikToker that I came across on the app on my For You page. Again, the page where they recommend certain content that they think you might enjoy or want to look at. Now, this TikToker's name is Dylan James Mulvaney. They have 1.9 million followers on TikTok, and I believe most of these followers were recently amassed, because when you go and look at the content that Dylan is putting out, it's following a day in the life of a man transitioning to be a woman. So these are the videos that I've looked through and sort of analyzed and thought about what my opinions were on them and how I think this affects not only the social media landscape, but just our culture and our country. So I've put together a compilation of these videos. Some of them were a little, I think, too inappropriate to show you. Very risque. Lots of showing of things that I don't think need to be shown particularly to anyone. But before we get into this and looking at the videos, I just want to put out a disclaimer. I will not be attacking Dylan in any way, shape, or form while you watch these videos. I am simply somebody who has seen this whole gender theory ideology play out, and it continues to play out and grow. And now we're seeing it grow among young people, it being taught in classrooms and even promoted to kids that gender confusion is a natural occurrence. It's something that we should all think about, and that young people should start to think about whether or not the gender that they were assigned at birth, as they say, is the true gender that they feel in their heart and in their mind. And I think the outcomes of such rhetoric and teaching, specifically in places like public school, where we're seeing this become a problem, can be very, very harmful. And we'll touch on why that can be harmful as we go through the episode, as we watch these videos, and as we react to them. I'd love to know how you feel about this in the comments. I'm sure some of you watching this are going to be people who adamantly disagree with my set of beliefs on this, as I tend to represent the more conservative end of things. But if you disagree, put that down in the comments below. Duke it out. If there's anything that you find that you agree with me on, or something that you wish I said while watching this, let me know as well, because I'm always trying to learn from you as well. This is a space for free thinking people, for free thoughts, and we want to really delve into these issues to the fullest extent and truly look at what our biases are, what my tendency is to, when I see things like this, to believe and to say, and we'll go through them. So we're going to start with Dylan's first video, at least the first video that I came across, day one of being a girl.
Day one of being a girl, and I have already cried 3 times. I wrote a scathing email that I did not send. I ordered dresses online that I couldn't afford. And then when someone asked me how I was, I said, I'm fine, when I wasn't fine. So. How'd I do, ladies? Good? Girl power.
Okay, so that's our introduction to Dylan. My first thought on this entire thing is that this is just satire. And clearly it's a joke based on what is believed to be typical female stereotypes. And I don't really have any strong thoughts on this. Of course, I do not personally believe that somebody who is a biological man can identify as female. And while I am a person who would respect the pronouns of somebody who wanted to be called she or her, and I will do so today as that arises, I do not believe that biological men can just identify and take on womanhood, which seems to be something that is getting widely accepted in this country. Now, one of the questions I ask myself is, what if a man had made this video and said, or somebody who identifies as a man had made this video and said, you know, today I identify as a woman and I do so by like writing a letter or saying that I'm fine when I'm not fine, and all these stereotypes of what it means to be feminine, being emotional, being sort of passive. I imagine, especially on the platform that is TikTok, that man would not do so well. I think they'd get eaten alive, and I could see the response videos that would be made by the feminists on this app. But it's okay to do so if you are part of this trans identity. And again, I think it's mainly a joke and a funny haha, so we're not going to look into it too much. But there's where I stand on transgenderism out the gate. I think if you are an adult person, which it seems like Dylan is an adult with a fully formed brain, and you want to make the decision to present yourself in a feminine manner and even go as far as medically transitioning to identify as female, by all means, do whatever it is that you want to do with your body. The issues that start to grow out of this for me are, A, when we start teaching this to children as something that is healthy and conducive to leading a successful, fruitful, happy life, and B, when we start compelling people with speech and sort of infringing on people's freedom of speech and saying, because I have proclaimed myself to be this, you must call me this. Now, of course, out of respect, I will refer to somebody around me as the pronouns or the name that they would like to be referred to as. I think it's quite rude to just not do that. But I don't think that it should be something that is placed into law or that we can infringe upon people on and say, you have to call me this. This is why we saw Jordan Peterson rise to fame in Canada for calling out the people at these universities. And I believe Bill C-16 that said, if somebody identifies as A, B, or C, you must call them A, B, or C, and you have no other option, or you will have repercussions based on that. So that's where I stand generally on this whole thing. It is amazing to me to see how much fame Dylan has garnered from making a video like this. This is day one alone, and the likes on this are at 464,000 likes, meaning that this video has been viewed by millions upon millions of people, and there are 8,650 comments on this. So clearly this is something that if you expose yourself on the internet and are vulnerable about this identity and show this to people, it is very well received, seemingly. Again, Dylan has 1.9 million followers. Let's skip ahead and look at day four of being a girl.
Day four of being a girl, and I am exhausted. The hair, the makeup, the clothes, the high heels, it's a lot to keep up with. And I need to learn early on that those things do not make me a girl. It's what's in here that matters. And I actually didn't shave my face today because I was like, Dill, even with your facial hair, you're a girl. And even though I'm having it removed, women can have facial hair and women can have body hair. And that's a beautiful thing. And that you are still a girl, Dylan. Okay. Woo-hoo. I don't need all those things. I love you.
Okay. So day four. Interesting that although often transgender individuals and what people who are progressive would call trans allies or people who promote this sort of narrative and promote this ideology would say that there's no such thing as gender roles for the most part. They would say just because, you know, girls are supposed to like pink and boys are supposed to like blue doesn't mean those things are real. They're really contrived. They're this sort of binary system that we've created as a society to make people conform. Yet when people begin to identify as transgender or identify with the opposite sex, they conform through the social standards that they said did not exist. And this is something that I recognized a while back when I was on the left. There was a trend, and I say this on the show quite often, there was a trend of wearing these shirts that said raise boys and girls the same. Girls don't like a certain set of things. Boys don't like a certain set of things. There's no definitive look for a boy. There's no definitive look for a girl. But in this transgender movement that we're seeing right now, we're seeing that binary, that socially constructed binary of what boys like and girls like, become so strong, if not more rigid than they would have been in a society that says that girls can be whatever and boys can be whatever. We see people, let's say if I identified as male, I would wake up in the morning and I would wear male clothes. I would start to wear more masculine colors. I would cut my hair in a masculine manner. I would go and start taking hormones to grow a beard. I would do the surgeries to look more male, even though we're saying at the same time that none of that makes up your gender and none of that is tied to sex whatsoever. So it's an interesting thing to have those two thoughts that are clearly in contention with each other live in the same space and in the same person. And to that I say, and to people who support this ideology specifically with kids, why can't we just have feminine men and masculine women? Why can't that simply be the case that I happen to be a girl that has more masculine likes, tendencies, attributes, or I happen to be a boy that has more feminine likes, tendencies, attributes? Why can't we just allow that to be what it is? Instead, we are telling kids that have those tendencies or those proclivities that this is a depiction of there being some sort of incongruence with your gender and the sex that you were assigned at birth, as they say. And I want to read this quote that Colin Wright, who is going to be on the show later this week on Thursday to do Devil's Advocate for Gender Theory, I hope you guys are around to see that, he shared on his Twitter. This quote says, "Knowing that it is anatomy that makes a child a girl or a boy lays the necessary foundation for constructing non-sexist gender identity, for understanding that being a girl or a boy does not depend on hair length, clothing, expression, or feelings, or play choices." So acknowledging that, yes, there is this somewhat binary system of men and women and boys and girls, but you can express yourself within that system in any way, shape, or form that you see fit, is truly a liberating thing, because it no longer means that there is a set of values or a presentation that is attached to being a woman or one that is attached to being a man. So really, that is more freeing and liberating than subscribing to the gender theory of today that says, because I identify as a woman, I need to grow my hair out, I need to get the breast augmentation, I need to get the bottom surgery, I need to get this, this, and that to make sure that to the world, I present as what the image of a woman is. So I'd be curious to ask that question. And I think we're going to find out through watching this video that Dylan has had many identification, maybe we could call them crises, throughout her life. We'll say her for the sake of this video. And that there has been stepping stones to coming out with this transgender identity. I can't imagine this is something that just happened overnight. I imagined it was a really long process that involved identifying with several different groups and wanting to feel comforted and wanting to feel a part of something. And I think right now in this society, coming out as trans is a really fast and effective way to quickly be accepted by a large group of people who will be there for you through the entire journey and always give you words of affirmation and support, which is truly a beautiful thing, but only beautiful if it truly accepts who you are as a person. Instead, I feel like this group of people is shouting affirmation and positivity at a person who feels really uncomfortable with who they are and who they were born as. And I'm not sure that that should be celebrated as much as truly accepting somebody for who they are and how they were born. But other than that, I think Dylan is a very happy and positive person. So that's a nice thing to see. So rarely do we see such proud positivity in today's day and age. Let's look at day six.
Day six of being a girl, and a lot of people are asking if I'm going to change my name. I really like Dylan, and I think that it's a great girl's name and that a lot of celebrities are naming their daughters Dylan. So in a way, I was just ahead of the trend. And the only other name that I could really see suiting this personality would be like Genevieve. And that's a mouthful. And I also don't think I know how to spell it. So Dylan it is. Love ya. Day six of being
okay.
A girl.
Nothing too controversial there in that video. It's interesting to me that so much of our identities now are not attached to morals and values or these sort of deeper set philosophical ideas that we have and we can share as individuals, but more so attached to labels. So much of this is surrounding, what is the sexual label that you have as an individual? What is your racial label? Can you please give me that? What are your pronouns? Can you please tell me the label that I need to put within the sentences that I refer to you as? And can you tell me your new name? That's another label that we need, and I need to have that for you to know who you are as an individual. And it seems that a lot of the conversation surrounding identity is attached to these very shallow, superficial labels. Your gender, your sexuality, and your name truly do not tell me much about you as a person, if anything at all. They tell me very little about you as a person, but we spend all of our time sitting and contemplating those things, and even when we present ourselves to people now, putting that before our names. Some people will identify themselves, oh, I'm a transgender woman and my name is Jen. It's so interesting that that becomes far more important than who you are as an individual. And so many people, again, I don't know, let's see how many views that got. That got 1.8 million likes. So this is the most liked one that we've seen so far. 1.8 million likes, which means this was probably seen by about 10 million people. And those 1.8 million were the ones who engaged in this. So clearly, there is a social community around this that is pushing and upholding this and loving this sort of thing. And I think it is truly a deviation from true individualism, even though a lot of the rhetoric around this is going to tell you this is people embracing who they are as an individual. This is people coming into their own and feeling free to express that. But is your name truly an expression of your individualism? That's my question to you guys. If you disagree with me, some people think names are of the utmost importance and a true reflection of who you are as a person. And if you do, tell me why you think that. But I don't. And it's amazing that 1.8 million people engaged with this in such a positive manner. Let's watch another one. This one doesn't have a specific day attached to it, I don't think. So let's see what's up with Dylan this day.
And on the seventh day, she rested. Day seven of being a girl, and oh my gosh, one whole week of being publicly a woman. I have learned so much, mostly good stuff. I don't think I've ever been this vulnerable in my entire life, but I've now realized that vulnerability is power, and it leads to connection, and it leads to good things. And, you know, these videos are mostly for me to look back on one day and go, oh my gosh, Dylan, look at all the things you learned, and I'm going to look so different and it's going to be amazing. But it's also, I think, really cool for women to think about all the things that they didn't even know they learned or that they didn't have to, that it just came naturally. And for trans people, you know, maybe you're seeing we're having some of the same struggles. And for men, maybe you don't even think about any of this stuff, but fun to have you here anyway. So I love you.
You know, some of this stuff leaves me just thinking in a sense that I'm like, I need far more time before I even comment on this. But there was the mention of vulnerability and vulnerability being powerful. Well, I do think vulnerability can be very important in your individual life, maybe around family and people are close to you. Vulnerability on the internet is a tricky thing for me. And we've seen this sort of evolution of social media that I think is going to cause a great downfall within younger generations. And that was really the birth of social media alone is probably something that was not healthy and not good for our society. And I contemplate my existence on social media quite often. But more so than that, social media began as this highlight reel of look how amazing my life is. And we saw the problems and the issues that stemmed from that, specifically with young girls watching social media content and going, wow, I'm seeing all these 19-year-olds who have a mansion and they're married and they have kids and they have this brilliant career and they're buying all these clothes and I'm 19 and I work at McDonald's. How horrible my life is. And people developing depression and anxiety surrounding that by seeing all these highlight reels. But now we're in this new age of social media where everything, every part of your life, the most vulnerable moments, the crying moments, the acts of depression, anxiety, your fights, the times that you've had the police called on you, everything is on social media. And I'm not sure that I would define that as powerful. And I'm not sure that I would say even vulnerability in its truest form is a powerful thing. I think it is something that is necessary and something that exists, but not sure that it's powerful. And you have to think about, again, the amount of fame, affirmation, and positivity that is being garnered in making these videos. And I have to wonder if that even constitutes being vulnerable anymore, because maybe it does in an individual sense. I, for one, was very trepidatious about putting my life on the internet in the beginning, and you become desensitized to it, and you'll see that Dylan becomes desensitized to it as well and can simply turn on the camera and say whatever she likes to say in these TikTok videos. But she's now famous because of this. 1.9 million followers. We'll talk about different brands and sponsorships that are being given to her because of these videos. But how much of that has to do with vulnerability? We'll see. I think there's certainly a perceived vulnerability. We view the trans community as being marginalized and particularly oppressed. When we think of oppressed groups in our political conversations, transgender definitely comes up specifically for people who identify with the progressive side of politics. So how much of that is real? And how much of that is a false perception? Because is it truly oppressive to be able to make videos like this on the internet and become famous off of it? Is that truly a moment of vulnerability? Again, if you have a clap back to that, please let me know. But I'm not seeing it. What I'm seeing is a lot of fame, attention, and money being garnered from this. And this is not a hit on Dylan by any means. She's living this life, I'm assuming, and this is her daily life, and this is how she's choosing to present herself and be in life, and it just happens to be on film, and people happen to love to watch it. You can't help if people like consuming the content that you make, and that's not your fault. But what does it say about the society that that's the content that makes people famous? Now let's move on.
Day 8 of being a girl, and I've gotten some messages that are saying that I need to be calling myself a woman and not a girl. And I didn't even know that some women were offended by being called girls, so that's really good to know. But for me, the word girl feels great because I never got to be one growing up, and it feels very able to make mistakes and growing and changing and evolving, whereas the word woman feels very strong and confident and powerful, and that still intimidates me a little bit. So I'm gonna keep calling myself a girl. Hope that's okay. Love ya.
Okay, where are my notes? I wrote notes on all these videos because I went through and watched them and wanted to get this right. And a lot of you are commenting in the comments right now and saying, why are you saying she? That is a he. Blah, blah, blah. I totally get that. I understand that a lot of you would choose not to use the pronouns of the person who's telling you that these are their pronouns. That is fully your right, as is addressed in our freedom of speech. I, out of respect and out of wanting to have a conversation with people who disagree with me on this, am choosing to call Dylan she, because one, I think I would do that to somebody who is standing in front of my face and ask me to call them that. And two, I really want to bridge the gap in the conversation here. And I can hop on here and say, Dylan's a man and there's no leeway for conversation on this and we need to all just call Dylan a man and shouldn't be able to transition and all these different things that I could say. But is that going to make somebody who disagrees with me watch the video and listen to my perspective? Probably not. 17-year-old me would have clicked that video and immediately turned it off. So for the sake of this video, I will continue to refer to Dylan as she, as it comes up. So one of the comments on that video that we just watched of Dylan saying, I'm going to continue to refer to myself as a girl rather than a woman, was, don't let cis women tell you what you can and can't do. You are a woman / girl. You have the right to your own choices / opinions on femininity. And so much of progressivism is just, I think, entangled with hypocrisy, because at the same time, we would tell a man, a biological man, that he cannot talk about pro-life or pro-choice. He cannot have these discussions because he's not a member of that group. Yet now we're telling a biological man, simply because they've made a self-proclamation of womanhood, that they can comment on whatever they want. And not only that, don't let cis women, which I disagree with that entire phrase, there's no such thing as a cisgendered woman. There is just women who were born that way and are biologically female. But don't let cis women tell you what you can and can't do. Now, obviously, I'm not hopping up here to tell anybody what they can and cannot do so long as you are an adult. But this idea that not only can you appropriate womanhood, but now you have the right to dictate what it means to be a woman, while biological women have no rights to tell you what womanhood is. And while we live in a culture that would get extremely upset if I turned on this live stream and was wearing an Indian headdress or a kimono of some sort, you guys would come after me, or many people would come after me and say, that is cultural appropriation. You are not a member of said group, therefore you cannot present yourself to be a member of said group. Those same people are so fine with something like this. And again, I am totally fine with men who present more feminine. If you're a man and you want to wear a dress and you want to call yourself Shirley and wear makeup and wear nails, do your own thing. But it's not then an onus on me to call you Shirley or to use the pronouns that you say. And it's definitely not something that should be recognized in law. And just as a side note, Dylan mentions in the video, I want to be called girl and not woman because I feel like woman has too much responsibility. And woman has this sense of power and strength that I don't identify with. I find myself to be very vulnerable and capable of making mistakes, and that's why I identify with girl. And it's, again, this idea that our feelings can start to dictate reality. The reality is that Dylan is a biological man. Now, if Dylan wants to call himself a woman, even so, the reality would be that you are an adult, therefore you would be a woman and not a girl. But still, even so, we can call ourselves a woman now, and not only that, we can call ourselves girls because we don't identify with the phrase woman. We have so quickly separated ourselves from any form of objectivity or reality just for the sake of feelings that we are harming people in ways that we don't even recognize anymore because we are just so controlled by those feelings and following those feelings. And we'll talk about how this can be harmful, and you're going to see some videos that truly point it out, and you're going to see people in the comments saying that these things are totally okay when in reality they are very, very harmful. But we sort of have, again, deviated from reality and also infantilized our society. I saw a video the other day of this girl crying in her car, saying, you know, I'm 28 years old and doing the things that come along with being 28 are too much. It's too much responsibility. I'm a baby. And she's crying her eyes out, which is such a sad thing to see. And I have really sympathy for being that age and not knowing what to do with your life. But at the same time, it does not mean that you're a baby. It means that you are currently a 28-year-old woman who is not ready to take on the responsibilities that come along with whatever phase of your life you're in. But that does not mean that we then shift, you know, the standards that we have for people of that age. And it's the same here. You can't call yourself a girl when you're simply not a girl just because you feel like that's what you are. Here is day 12.
Day 12 of being a girl, and I just picked up some tampons, and y'all are probably thinking, Dylan, where are you gonna put those? They're not for me. But this last weekend, I was in the restroom, and the girl in the stall next to me was like, hey, do you have a tampon? And I froze. I was like, sorry, no. But in that moment, I decided, you know what? I'm always gonna have one on hand for anyone who needs it. You come over to my house and we're having a glass of wine, I got a tampon for you. If we're in the club together and then we go to the bathroom, I got a tampon for you. Women supporting women. Love ya.
Okay. So let's get into some things that I see here. Very nice thing to do for a fellow person. However, there was mentions of being in the women's bathroom. We'll talk about that because it does come up in another TikTok video later. I have qualms with that. And after this video, and let's see how viral this video went, 4.7 million likes, guys. Every time I check, it goes up and up and up and up. I can't even fathom how many people that means have seen this video. 4.7 million likes on this. And what happened subsequent to this? Who saw those 4.7 million likes? Tampax, the company that makes the tampons that Dylan is holding in this video, contacted Dylan and said, we want to sponsor you. So a brand for feminine products for women is sponsoring a transgender TikToker who cannot use their product because they have proclaimed themselves to be a woman. You know, I like to exercise a fair amount of empathy for these situations and understanding for these situations, but it's become very clear that there is not only profit being garnered from pushing forward these theories, but just a complete F you to women and the things that we have to go through. A transgender person is never going to experience a monthly cycle, unless scientifically we have some innovation where that starts to become the case. How many of them are going to sign up to experience that every month? I have no idea if that ever becomes a thing. But they do not experience that. So to be a woman that has to go through this every single month, and then to go and buy your Tampax and have a transgendered woman be the sponsor on that product? Do we really, like, are we not seeing that as demeaning, as a slap in the face? And I it really begs the question, and so much of this begs the question of, where are feminists on these issues? Why are they not speaking? Because as much as I want to be kind to people who have this identity, and I will be kind to people who have those identities, we have to draw lines in the sand and boundaries that cannot be crossed, because once they are, we start causing harm to people. Now, people might see a Tampax sponsorship as not being particularly harmful, but what about when we say that transgender women can now participate in female sports? Okay, that's a step up from being sponsored in a Tampax commercial, a product for women. Now we're in sports. Okay, some people look at that and go, well, that's totally fine. What if we step up from that and we say a man who identifies as a woman can start going into female bathrooms? And some people go, well, they're just going there to do their business. There's nothing wrong with that. Okay, let's step it up further. A man who identifies as female certainly shouldn't be in a male prison, should he? So let's transfer that man who identifies as female to a female prison, and let's see how successful that experiment is. But wait, it's not an experiment anymore. It's actually happening. So you have to think about the different steps of accepting this as a reality are, because they are harming people, and the feminists are very, very quiet on this issue. Nobody's calling it out, because technically what? If you agree with this reality, you'd be accepting this person as a woman. So I did a reel on this the other day, and there's a short on my channel that you guys can go and check out. But two women in a New Jersey prison facility, a female facility, are now pregnant. Why? Because they, in New Jersey, allowed men who identify as women to transfer over to female facilities. Now, I don't know whether or not the whatever occurred between these two individuals, three individuals in prison, was consensual or not, but it certainly should not be happening. What's going to happen to those children who are born to mothers in prison? It should have never happened. We should have never been put in a situation where that is possible. Yet here we are today because people have decided to suspend reality for the sake of feelings. The very same thing is happening in California, where now a male inmate can put in papers to identify as female and be switched over. And it obviously begs the question, are these people really people experiencing body dysphoria? Or are they men who go, would be so great to be around women right now instead of getting sexually assaulted by other men in prison. I would love to be in a room full of women. And then they go and sign some papers and off they go. And we know this to be the case in many ways, not in all, but in many ways, because the rate of transgenderism showing up in the prison population is higher than the rate of it in actual society, in our country, and people who are not incarcerated. So we have to think about silent victims of the radical sort of social justice movements that we advocate for, because there will be silent victims in almost every single decision that you make. There will be somebody who's victimized by it in some way, shape, or form. Now, is us accepting people's pronouns and being able to go to the bathroom, is that worth the women who would be sexually assaulted? I would say no. And I think that anybody who would say, yes, that's totally worth it, needs to reevaluate, because I don't think it's worth it whatsoever. Let's move on to day 13.
Day 13 of being a girl, and it feels like Christmas morning. I am finally going to get laser hair removal on my face and my body, and I could cry, I'm so excited.
Hi everyone, okay, I'm with Nina here at Sev, and we're gonna do my chest, my abs, and my face today, and I'm a little nervous.
No. Y'all, I hardly felt it.
The process was oddly satisfying, and this above the lip was probably the most sensitive area, but it just sort of feels like rubber bands, and I want to get this beard gone, baby.
Everyone, I look a little crazy right now, but it was no big deal at all. Nina was amazing. Go back every 4 weeks. Just finished my session, and honestly, I don't look as bad as I thought I was going to. Really excited about this journey, and thank you, Sev.
Okay, so this is day 13, undergoing laser hair removal. And I think there's a lot of things attached to this. And what I think about is how much discomfort somebody might be feeling to have to go through operations and body augmentation procedures that are so uncomfortable. This one is definitely less uncomfortable on the whole scale of transgender medical transitioning. But we're talking laser hair removal, facial reconstruction, lip filler, Botox, in many cases, hormone shots, which are, I'm assuming, not comfortable, bottom surgery and getting your genitalia reconfigured, breast augmentation. This is a massive gauntlet of things to have to undergo in order to feel okay with yourselves. And we know through the studies on transgenderism and sex reassignment surgery and all these processes that at the end of it, they're still not feeling okay with themselves. And the suicide rate is tremendous when compared to other groups in our society. So all of this really shouts to me, an individual who's uncomfortable. And it makes me sad to see somebody who's so uncomfortable being what they were born as and growing into what they were born as, and even with all the quirks of liking feminine things or being a feminine person. Now, I see a lot of people in the comments saying, well, Amala, you don't think this is the reality, but you still refer to somebody with the pronouns that they choose. And yes, I think where my argument lies on this is that you all should have the choice. Everybody should have the choice as to whether or not they refer to somebody as the pronouns that they would like to have. And that is everybody's choice. It should continuously be everybody's choice. But right now, there's a group of very loud fringe activists, I don't even know if they're becoming fringe anymore, it's becoming quite a mainstream idea, that say that because you choose not to, you should be fined, there should be legal action, this is a hate crime, this is hate speech, and this whole idea that the words that we say can constitute violence, which I completely disagree with, and I don't think hate speech exists. But that's my issue. The compelled speech is the issue. And you'll hear very similar statements from people like Jordan Peterson, who, if there is a trans person in his class, which, when he was working in Canada as a professor, he would say, absolutely, I will refer to you as the pronouns that you ask for, but I should not get in trouble if I don't. And you'll find there are many conservatives who will do the same. If somebody walks up to you and says, if I walk up to you and say, my name is Harry and not Amala, and you go, okay, Amala, that would be fine, I guess, and that's something that you can do, and I don't think you should get in trouble for doing that. But again, it's everybody's choice, and I will honor what an adult would like to be called. I don't think there's any reason for me not to do that. I can understand why people wouldn't, but at the end of the day, it's not going to change the way that they identify and the way they view the world. If anything, I think it can make people even more adamant about getting younger and younger people to do the things that they are doing. I think if somebody is truly willing to go through this process of changing themselves in this way, far be it from me to not call you the pronouns that you want to be called, but I don't expect other people to. That's what freedom of speech is, and it's what it should always be. Now, we're going to move on to day 17. The bearded lady, this one's called.
I really didn't want to make this video because I feel embarrassed, but I'm just going to do it. Day 17 of being a girl, and I am the bearded lady. I got laser hair removal last week, and I am now not allowed to shave for 7 days. And it's been torturous to look at myself in the mirror and see somebody that I don't want to be or look like. And when I decided to make this video series, I was like, Dylan, we're going to show the good and the bad. And this is one of the bad days for me. And I've been kind of hiding out in my house for the last few days, but tonight I'm gonna go see a play. I put my Princess Diana sweater on, and I'm gonna wear my mask. And for trans people, these masks can be little safety blankets at times, especially when I've got my facial hair. So there's one good thing to come from the pandemic, but I just have to trust the process that it's all gonna be worth it, and that I am gonna look like I want to one day. And I love you.
Bye. Oh, man. Okay. So many things here. That video is like 1 minute, but it is so telling. So, so telling. Imagine thinking that throughout this pandemic, masks are a great thing because you get to cover up your face, the face that you were born with, and that you feel so tortured by the way that you look and by the way that people perceive you, that you're willing to wear a mask day in and day out. And in fact, he even mentioned not leaving his house. Now, so often when we talk about transgenderism, people just talk about it as if it's like this trendy, people want to be it. And I think there is a part of that. And that's why social media is a particular problem with that, because it's creating a group of people who want to be this because of the clout, because of the fame, because of the attention, and then realizing, oh, wait, that's not good. But I think we should acknowledge that there are people who do experience gender dysphoria. And to me, experiencing something like that sounds horrible. It sounds horrible to wake up every day and look down at yourself and go, I am disgusted by this. I don't want other people to see me like this. I don't want to be this way. And willing to go through all of these different surgeries and different augmentations to make yourself be perceived in a way that truly people on the outside don't even care about. Like, people aren't thinking about you as much as you think about you. So imagine the torturous cycle of that, and then going through that and still not being okay with yourself. Imagine how horrible that must feel, and just constantly be chasing something that you truly cannot be and is really a band-aid on top of a mountain of other issues. And we'll get to this in other videos, but Dylan suffers from anxiety and depression, which is very often a precursor to feeling body dysphoria and going down the route of going through these medical transitions and seeing psychiatrists and wanting to, you know, get boobs and chop things off and all these things. Now, those things should be addressed, and that's what we should be talking about. I don't think there's anybody that denies that this condition exists. What we disagree on is the treatment. And now we live in a culture where if you don't affirm that and say that medical transitioning is the best treatment, you are a bigot, you are a transphobe, doctors can't do it, scientists can't do it, people on the internet can't do it without being censored. I talk all the time about this issue on TikTok, or at least try to, and I put the videos up and they don't last more than an hour. I told you guys one lasted 55 minutes, another 11 minutes, and another 50 minutes before being taken off the platform, and nothing heinous being said. Just saying that this is not a good thing to teach children, and we should think about other forms of treatment for this and other forms of treatment that have better outcomes than this high rate of suicide, depression, and anxiety. Because as much as we just want to affirm people and say, yeah, you can be whatever you want to be, and let's give you your shots, let's give you the surgery, which is what a lot of progressives want to do, it's not helping the outcomes. So are you really saving trans lives like you say you are? Are you really advocating for trans people like you say you are if the outcomes do not change? Probably not. So I get that everybody is coming to this issue with compassion and everybody's trying to do the right thing. But why are we not looking at the results objectively, looking at these studies that show there's no change in mental health after this and going, wait a second, maybe we should be teaching people who come to our clinics with these problems to accept themselves the way that they are and explore the different things that they like in the body that they were born with, in the gender that they were born with, in the sex that they were born with. Why can't we just encourage that? And I think more than ever now in today's current society, people would be largely accepting of a feminine man. They really are. Like, people don't look at our look at the heartthrobs of the modern society that we're in right now. TikTok e-boys, Harry Styles, who wears dresses and nail polish on any given occasion, and Timothy Chalamet, who's a very effeminate man. So we know that feminine men are widely accepted. Why are we not viewing people who struggle with their gender in the same way? Because they're coming with the same statements. I like to wear dresses. I like the color pink. I like nail polish. I like these girly things. I like hanging out with girls more. I identify with girls more. Yet we don't say that Harry Styles is transgender. We don't say that Timothy Chalamet is transgender. We don't say that about all these TikTok e-boys that paint their nails and grow their hair long. But we say that to these people. Somebody explain that to me, because I have no idea. No idea why that's the case. In this next one, I don't have a lot of commentary on it, but I recognized Dylan when I saw his face from Broadway, the Book of Mormon. And at the time, played a character in the Book of Mormon where it's like these Mormon boys who knock door to door, whatever. It's a comedy. But here's this video of Dylan singing.
I am woman. I am fearless. I am sexy. I'm divine. I'm unbeatable. I'm creative.
I'm not going to show much more of that, but just look at the talent of just like, if you accepted yourself for who you are and just followed that to the truest extent, you would just be a man who likes feminine things, who can sing and is talented. And I'm sure you'd get a lot of appreciation and a job and a career that you like and a life that you like. But instead, we're taking on this new identity and getting even more fame because of it, even more. And I don't want to make any accusations here. I just want to state the facts that Dylan is a musical theater performer, or at least was a musical theater performer, also an actor, and also was like on The Price is Right, which, you know how like theatrical and actory you have to be on The Price is Right. I think a lot of this is playing into what we know people want to see. And as somebody who does make TikToks and make content like this, like, you know, there's, you do several takes, you play up certain things, you get an emotional feel for the videos that you make, and sometimes you scrap videos because it doesn't have the feeling that you want to give it. I imagine Dylan does the same with their videos and just films and films and films until they get a video that they think is going to be well received by other people. And I imagine plays into this sort of vulnerable, exposing myself, bringing awareness and hashtag trans visibility to get followers. I imagine that's a part of anybody's motivation who is making TikToks on a day-to-day basis and getting such a big audience from it. I'm going to bet $10 right now that Dylan has like a TV show, a massive brand deal, or like a huge YouTube channel in a matter of a year. Because that is what celebrity is these days. It's people who are identifying with these niche, marginalized groups and then making videos of it. And then they get this massive wave of support, even though they're part of an oppressed community. And then they become famous. And Dylan's already been featured on Good Morning America and is an actress. So I can't wait to see what comes out of that. I'm sure it's going to be some sort of TV show or something, because very rarely does fame like this that has grown so exponentially so quickly go unnoticed and not taken up by massive corporations, as we saw with the Tampax brand deal. They don't care whether or not it aligns with their brand, whether or not it aligns with reality. They care about what people's eyes are on, whether that's positive or negative. Here is day 20.
Hello, I'm in my canopy bed. And it's day 20 of being a girl, and today is the trans day of visibility. Can you see me? I have never felt this visible before, and it's kind of scary and amazing, especially being a trans woman.
Scary and amazing.
20, I just mean that 20 days of publicly being a woman. There's been so many moments of my life when I've craved, you know, being a girl, feeling like a girl, and now I'm finally living it. And that.
If there is anybody who is trans watching this right now, which I doubt, but maybe down the line somebody will watch this for the sake of disagreeing with me, but or maybe just from listening to my views on this, which I'm hopeful will happen. What does craving to be like a girl mean? If we say that gender roles don't exist, we say that to be a girl doesn't mean anatomy, to be a girl doesn't mean chromosomes, to be a girl doesn't mean the clothing and all this stuff. It doesn't mean to be emotional. It doesn't mean to be passive. It doesn't mean to be nurturing and caring. What does it mean to crave being a girl? Because all that I've gotten from people who talk about this is, oh, it's simply a feeling. It's simply a feeling. You feel it in your brain and you know. But then why do all these other things come along with it? Subscribing to gender roles and sort of this conformist view of what it means to a woman. What does it truly mean to crave being a girl? And we saw this question be asked in a different form. What does it mean to be a woman to our Supreme Court, now confirmed a Supreme Court Justice, Brown? And we got no answer there. So I'm curious to see if we will ever get an answer on what that means. Because right now it is just this floating idea in the ether that is ungrabbable from any perspective. Here is day 22.
Hey, it's Saturday night. I'm having a glass of wine. I deserve it. It's day 22 of being a girl, and I figured it's about time I tell you about my love life. What do you think? I have yet to be kissed as a girl. Can you believe it? I haven't been on a date in years, and in a way, I feel like a virgin again. I mean, part of me is like, Dylan, just get it over with. And then part of me is like, no, wait for somebody really special. But do you remember that dilemma? Like, I feel like I'm having it all over again. It's deja vu.
I see this deep need to relate, to want to be accepted by a group of people and to put out these relatable phrases and things that all women can sort of see and attach themselves to and go, yeah, okay, well, that means you must be a woman too, because you're seeing this and you're going through my experience just a little later in life. And as much as so many people can see that and want it to be true, it is not true. And I see a lot of you in the comments saying, you know, sex is not a feeling. It is a reality. It is a fact. And of course, I have a tendency to agree with you and believe that. I think that it goes down to the chromosomes that you are born with, even though there's people trying to say that that's not true at all. I think that's what it is. It's sort of this immovable fact that will be a constant for women and a constant for men, and it will be unchangeable, regardless of what sort of augmentation and alterations you make to your body on the outside. That is not going to change unless we have some sort of scientific innovation that happens later. And when I'm sure somebody's working on it, unbelievable, but I'm sure somebody's working on it. But that's not going to change. And that's the reality of sex for me. But it's interesting to see that other people have this different idea of it, but they can't define what that idea is. And you guys saw the famous clip of Matt Walsh being on Dr. Phil and saying, what is a woman? And them saying, you know, we can't define it. A woman's anything. It's whatever anybody says it is, and it's whatever they want to be. And I can't get how women are okay with hearing that. There are things that are completely unique to being a woman with, you know, with our female chromosomes. It's completely unique to that. Experience is completely unique to that. And for as long as we've been screaming and crying about patriarchy, no, I haven't. I did in the past, but not anymore, because I don't agree that we live in a patriarchal society. But as much as some women scream about patriarchy and the oppression of men, they are still on the other side of the coin, so fine with men going, I'm you now. I'm exactly what you are, and I experience everything that you experience. And in fact, I feel the oppression that you experience too. So are transgender women just as oppressed as biological women? Can somebody answer that? Do they also experience patriarchy? And if so, have they experienced it their entire life since they've been a woman their entire lives, according to this ideology? And we've seen this sort of come to fruition with stories like Elliot Page, who was, what was the original name? Ellen Page? Ellen Page, who now identifies as Elliot Page. And Ellen Page, when identifying as a woman, would scream and cry about how white men were the most oppressive group in our society. They were constantly holding her down, and they were just this oppressive force on all these marginalized groups, including women. But Ellen Page now identifies as Elliot Page, a white male. So do you also have the white male privilege? And did you have that your entire life since you've been a white male your entire life? Or is all of this something that we've just created and born out of our minds, and that's why it has so many plot holes and so many contradictions? I am going to guess that it is the latter. We've run so much with feelings that we forgot to account for fact and objectivity, and suddenly we are in this walking contradiction of ourselves that is so entrenched in falsehood that nobody even cares to question it any further than looking at what's on the surface level. Here is day 25.
Girl, and I am on my way to yoga class for the first time as a woman. And I actually used to be a yoga instructor, but I haven't gone because I've been so nervous about the locker room situation. Because actually the last time I went, I used the men's locker room a few months ago, and a guy walked in and was like, oh my gosh, this is the men's locker room. And I was like, ah! But I have my mask. I'm going in, wish me luck. That wasn't that scary. I made a friend in there, and the woman's locker room smells so much better than the men's, FYI. And if you're afraid to use the locker room with a trans person, this is what you're afraid of. So let's just pick a different battle to fight. Am I right? Love you.
You're not right. You're not right. There's not a different battle to pick to fight. And this is why, this is the slippery slope. And if we've slipped all the way down the slope, hit our heads on a rock, we're concussed, we're trying to get back up, and we can't. We're basically gonna die after falling and tripping over ourselves down this slope. This is where we are. And to say something like, if you have a problem with trans people being in the locker room, this is what you're afraid of. And to think that because you are a biological man who happens to be very meek and feminine, that makes it less of a problem is completely incorrect. We've seen this play out We Spa here in Los Angeles. We saw a massive bout of protests happen at that spa after a biological man said, I identify as a woman, and they went, okay, go ahead, go to the women's locker room, go to the women's spa. And this man exposed himself, as women do in spas, to women and children in the women's section of this spa. That is not okay. Just like transgender women being in female sports is not okay. It is a biological man in a female space, and that is not okay. So to think that just because you are meek and more emotional and more feminine presenting that it's okay does not make it okay. And again, you open the door for men who are predators and just want to abuse the system and abuse women to go, hey, what up, bro? I identify as a woman. That's what you open it up for. That's what you open it up for. And it's happened numerous times now. The story out of Loudoun County, a girl raped twice in her school bathroom by a boy who says, oh, well, I'm a girl. And has now been criminally prosecuted, luckily. But this has happened on several occasions. It's something that J.K. Rowling is fighting against in her home country now, which is Sweden, where they're saying, you know, a man can rape a woman and say, I'm a female, and they'll book him as a female. Clown world. Let's see. We have a couple more to go here, and then we'll close out the show for today. Day 26.
Day 26 of being a girl, and I have a journal entry from me to you. I have been getting quite a few messages from lovely people saying, this must be so hard. I'm sure you're going through a lot, etc. And I cherish every single one. And I respond with, oh, I'm having a great time. All is well here. Well, the honeymoon phase may be over. Last night I had a panic attack. I felt scared for the first time in weeks. Of the unknown, of letting people down, of not getting everything right. I now know why trans people go into their cocoons for long periods before fully coming out. This girl that I am becoming, that I am, is still so new and fragile. I cannot expect perfection from her. A newborn isn't 100% confident as it takes its first steps.
There's so little confidence. Actually, yes, so somebody commented I did mean Scotland, not Sweden, when I was talking about J.K. Rowling. There's clearly underlying mental health issues that are present here. You've already heard him say depression and anxiety is something that he struggles with. So that's there as well. And I can mess. I think I've said three different sets of pronouns this entire video all over the place. It's very hard to keep up with. But either way, there's clearly these underlying issues present here that are driving this current identity. And Dylan said, oh, I identified as gay, then queer, then non-binary, and now trans. So it shows you there's just a little ladder that we are constantly stepping up and stepping up and stepping up to a new identity and a new identity and a new identity. And yet none of the identities fix the underlying problem, which is often depression and anxiety. It needs to be grappled with, and it needs to be confronted, but it's not being confronted. It's just being blindly affirmed, going, okay, this will make you feel better. This will make you feel better. Oh, it didn't? Oh, it didn't? Oh, I'm not sorry, actually. I'm going to do it to the next person and the next person and the next person. And any doctor or scientist that says, no, we don't need to do this. We need to save these lives. We're just going to excommunicate them, and we're not going to allow them to participate in the conversation anymore because their data is somehow invalid, even though it's showing the horrendous outcomes here. So we have to address the underlying issues. So much of what we just heard was, I want to do the right thing. I want people to look at me kindly. I want to be confident. I want people to accept me. What about just wanting to be true to who you are and who you were born as? Not the figment of who you are, but who you were born as. There's none of that. There's none of that. It's all this perception from other people, and clearly other people want you to be doing this. What did we say? Like 3 million likes, 4.7 million likes, millions and millions and millions of followers and watchers, and Good Morning America and Tampax commercials, and a beauty brand coming out and saying, we want you as the face of our beauty brand. People are pushing you in a certain direction, and it's not conducive for your health. It's not going to be conducive for a good society, as we're seeing with the numbers there. And I think that's where we'll end, because we are hitting 4 o'clock. You guys can go and check out more of these videos. I've linked the TikTok down below if you want to go and see it. There is far more to be seen and to be discussed here. But this is internet celebrity now. This is what gets you fame, attention, money, followers, and affirmation unlike any form of affirmation I have ever seen. And there's a significant amount of fame surrounding this identity, even though it is claimed to be a marginalized group. And you should question that. You should question that. When what you're seeing with your eyes contradicts what is being told to you and what is being said, there's probably something else going on. And I'm not talking about anything in the vein of conspiracy. This could be just simple, basic confusion. Although when we're looking at everything that's happening right now, Disney pushing this stuff, schools pushing this stuff, corporations pushing this stuff, mainstream media, although I call it legacy media, also being in massive support, lockstep support of these measures and of teaching people this, it is hard not to believe that there is some just congruent effort of people to accept this and normalize this, which we all know normalization is the final stage in a lot of these ideologies. And this is very brazen. It's out there. It's everywhere. And on the front of audience, it's a young, susceptible, malleable, impressionable audience of people that is watching this. And you have to imagine that there are young kids seeing this and going, oh, maybe I'm confused with my gender too. But I don't want to wait until I'm 20-something to figure it out after I've already gone through puberty and already had, you know, it's going to be a much more rougher process to transition. I need to do it before puberty. That's what people are saying. They're saying if you catch this before puberty, allow kids to transition because it's going to be a smoother process for them so that they don't have to reverse all the stuff that happens to them down the way. Concerning. Problematic. Extremely problematic. And we're going to delve into why that is a massive problem later on Thursday with a new episode of Devil's Advocate with Colin Wright, who is an evolutionary biologist and is very outspoken about gender theory and the practice of it. And he's also a writer for Quillette and doing his own thing as well. So we're going to discuss that on Thursday on the show, where I will play the leftist view of things and he completely destroys me, I must say. So you guys will get to see that. Watch your social media consumption, especially if you're a parent watching this right now. Check out what your kid's watching on social media, if they even have it at all. I would hope that if they're a young child, they don't have social media. But again, the reality is far different from what our hopes are and what we are optimist towards. So if your kids have social media, check and see what they're watching, because it could very well be this sort of content. And while they are going to be exposed to it, they are going to see it, that is a fact of life. You should have some say in when that happens, how that happens, and whether or not a positive message of affirmation is surrounding that. I'm by no means saying that Dylan deserves negativity for experiencing life in this way and making these decisions, but fame and brand deals from female companies and shows and beauty brands and things like that makes me question just at large how we are moving and what direction this goes in. Because again, it doesn't stop when they've achieved what they've set out to achieve in this particular problem with gender theory. It does not stop there. There's always something new, because 5 years ago, while transgender people did exist, it certainly wasn't an issue that we were bringing to the forefront of our political conversations, but now it is. So urge yourself to think about what comes after this. And if we choose as a society to accept that reality is suspendable and morphable and we can move it around and say, make proclamations about what we think something is and have people blindly affirm that, what is the next proclamation we're able to make? Is it transracial? Is Rachel Dolezal gonna make a reappearance and suddenly be accepted by the world because we don't accept her for saying she's transracial, but we accept people who appropriate womanhood and manhood and say that they're a gender that they weren't born as? So is the next thing transracial? Is the next thing age? So much of what we live in is social construct. Virtually everything is social. The time of day right now, which is 4:03 p.m. over on the Pacific, that's a social construct. Are we suddenly going to go, well, that's not my reality, it's actually 6:30 where I am right now, and you all have to accept that, and you have to go make me dinner, because 6:30 is dinner time. So, yeah, what social constructs are we able to push and pull and move? Because we should probably decide that, figure that out, and decide how harmful it is as well. I think that sums up my thoughts on this. If you disagree with me. Let me know where you disagree with me. I know a lot of you disagree with my choice to say, use the pronouns she, her for Dylan, although I do that out of respect. Many of you wouldn't. Some of you probably disagree and accept transgenderism and think everything should be fine. We can teach kids to do whatever they want and kids know who they are. Let them express that and let's affirm that for them. And tell me why you believe that. Show me any studies you have to prove that that is something that is healthy for young people or even adults, because I struggle finding any sort of evidence that shows that it's good for them either. And is there something you wish I had said or wish I had touched on that I did not in this video? We are a group of free thinkers, hopefully, whether or not you fall on my side of the aisle, and we will have the discussion in the comments. I've been going through and responding to some of your YouTube comments on previous videos. I will do so with this one as well. We do this show every single weekday at 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern. Although, who knows, in a few years, we might be able to just say whatever time, and you guys will just have to show up when I show up. We're also on Spotify, Google Play, Apple Podcasts, if you'd rather listen than watch here on YouTube and here on Facebook. We're also on Rumble, hopefully on Getter. At least we're having some technical difficulties on there, but I think we're on Getter as well, so you can follow us there. And comment down below any other topics you'd like me to talk about this week. Also, follow me on Instagram because I take a lot of your input from my other social media platforms and input it into the show in the discussions that we have. So go and follow me there as well. We will be back tomorrow with a new subject matter to discuss. So I hope to see you there. Please like, subscribe, and click the notification. Bye, guys.